is associated with the natural products and also the synthetic biology. And I work in the area of osteoporosis and phytoestrogens. And of course, today I have chosen the topic in another area, that is lead and Alzheimer's. Lead, you all know that it's a heavy metal. And Kartik, shall I share the screen?
Sir, please open the PPT and then the center green button. Yes, sir. And then full screen.
Is it visible?
Yes, sir, it is visible.
Yeah. See, the why I have chosen this area is heavy metal. Lead is a heavy metal, you all know that, and it causes neurodegenerative issues, and it is a toxic heavy metal to the brain. And upon the study, we have been studying for last 10 years in this area, and we found that lead is showing a kind of issues like oxidative stress, apoptosis, inflammatory changes, and other things. And there is an issue, the Alzheimer's. Alzheimer's patient is also having similar kind of what you call metabolic issues. And suppose when I was at US with the NIH visiting scientist fellowship, there was a professor raised an issue saying that because Alzheimer's patient is also having similar kind of neurotoxicity issues, if he is living in a place where lead is there heavily in the environment, what could be the situation? So then I started doing this kind of research. Mostly I could be the person, one of the person working in this area in India. And so I'll try to give a brief presentation of initially about lead and amyloid peptides. And slowly I'll go into the natural compound like epigallocatechin gallate, which you all know that it is a bioactive ingredient in the consume, what you consume every day, like tea and guava and like other many foods. Because I'm working in the National Institute of Nutrition, I need to have the food component as one of the important research areas. So if you see, initially I will speak about the toxicity, and later I'm going to lead this topic into the my research findings. The title of this work goes like this: lead and amyloid peptides induce neurotoxicity in human brain cells. Because I have chosen human brain cells as the model here, because directly it is having effect on the brain cells. So we have cultured the human brain cells in the laboratory and try to see the effects. We normally try to simulate the situation, like a toxicity situation in the brain cells, by exposing lead. And for Alzheimer's, it is like amyloid peptides. What are amyloid peptides and why they cause toxicity? I'll let you know in my during my presentation. And whether any kind of natural compound has got any kind of protection against these toxicities. See, heavy metals are toxic to the human health. You all know that. And they are non-degradable, and they have serious health consequences. And they're said to be very toxic and poisonous at even low concentrations. Many of the people doesn't know that regularly what we have, the paints and other things, paints, glass, ceramics, automobile, gasoline, all these things has got lead as an inbuilt molecule. And when it is get exposed to the environment, even in low concentrations, it is very much toxic and said to be very poisonous. And the most commonly used heavy metal, means observable heavy metals, are lead and mercury, cadmium, and arsenic. You all know about that. These are, although they are air pollutants, and consumption of contaminated drinking water also leads to the exposure to the human body. And the industrial waste also has uh, uh, See, Karthik, I am getting all messages, some messages like admit, all those things. Can you please remove all those things? How to remove that window? I'm getting that constantly problem. Okay. So exposure to this when it leaches to the soil and the soil gets contaminated through industrial waste. And the consumption of these kinds of soil or water affected with the lead is going to be very costly, and it causes toxicity to the humans, mostly to the nervous system. So the main food sources such as vegetables, grains, fruits, fish and shellfish, we can come across every day in day-to-day life, and they can be contaminated by accumulating these metals from the surrounding soil and the water. And because this leaches into the soil and also through industrial effluents, through water, it goes into the soil, and these plants take up that one, and that we consume regularly, like vegetables, fruits and other things. Even in these waters, the fish and shellfish, these will grow. Those also we take, and through that also we get, body will get contaminated with this kind of heavy metals. And you all know that the serious health consequences because of this kind of exposure is reduced growth and development. You can see in the children. Children are the most affected group, where they can the growth will be retarded, and the developmental phase in the brain is also gets retarded. And cancer, organ damage, nervous system damage, and in extreme cases even death also we can see because of these exposures. And basically these are produced by the industrial activities. And it can deposit slowly into the surrounding water and soil. You know, if you see the little bit background of water exposures and how they're toxic to the system, there are three types of exposures, like acute, chronic, and chronic and subchronic. And acute is very short term. A single exposure lasting for less than 24 hours. So you can something get exposed to the body and it lasts for 24 hours. And the chronic is long-term, little bit long-term, and exposes essentially for the lifetime. This gets slowly get exposed to the body, and it is a very chronic exposure. And it leads to the lifelong exposure to the body, and it causes toxicity throughout your lifetime. And subchronic is repeated exposures of less than a lifetime, that is 3 months. In 3 months interval time, it gets exposed to the body, and body gets retained that one, and the toxicity inside, because it gets absorbed into the body, it slowly work with the body, and it causes toxicity to different systems. And you see the acute and chronic exposures among these two. The acute is a dose delivered in a single event, for example, in single attempt, you are traveling somewhere and just get exposed quickly, and a single, this is called a single event, and it gets into the body and it causes damage and toxicity to the system. And chronic is you are repeatedly, you are traveling from office to your home, and traveling every day, you are going through an industry, slowly you are getting exposed to small doses over a long period of time, and allows gives a chance to get accumulate very slowly. And this causes deleterious effects in the body, and it affects several metabolic pathways in the body. And basically, the chemical structure of the parent drug, that is its metabolite or a chemical structure or a parent molecule, which causes toxicity to the system. And this can be produced by enzymes or light of or reactive oxygen species. So this kind of exposures leads to this toxicity to the body. And these, what are the types of reactions? Reactions are maybe pharmacological, pathological, or a genotoxy, and maybe pharmacology is drug dose effects, and the pathological is it causes a systemic damage, and the genotoxic is it can pass on to the generations. So depending on the concentrations of the chemical, normally the toxic effects of these elements are reversible. Sometimes, some situations these are irreversible also. The pharmacological effects are discontinued due to the biotransformations. So sometimes the metabolites which gets neutralized in the body and they cause lesser toxicity to the body. So these pathological and genotoxic effects can be repairable, and they needs a repair mechanism in the body. We have several repair mechanisms. I don't want to go into the details of the repair mechanisms in the body, but body can adjust and cope up automatically and gets try to repair this kind of toxicities. And if you see the local versus systemic toxicity, local toxicity occurs at the site at first contact between the toxicant and the biological system, and the systemic toxicity requires it gets into the body through absorption process and gets distributed in the body and whole body it can travel and it causes toxicity, and this is particularly is called as a toxicant. And the toxicant can cause by both these effects like local toxicity and systemic toxicity. And the severity of the local toxicity depends on the portal of entry. So how it is getting into the body. For example, now we can see the COVID-19 situation. The port of entry is through the eye or the lips or through the what we call the nasal way. So this kind of port of entry causes a very tough situation in the body. And the severity of the toxicity will be decided by the port of entry. And whether these are reversible or irreversible, prohibitively the toxic drugs causes irreversible toxicity. There are some drugs which causes severe toxicity to the body. They are irreversible. And the ability of the tissue to reverse the drug toxicity depends on the tissue capacity to regenerate and repair. So as I said already, body has got the capacity to recoup the situation where the toxicity is being generated. So you see, the mitochondria is one of the target molecule or organelle which has got mainly the exposure of these molecules, and it takes up all kinds of toxicity effects. For example, the free radicals which gets the membrane gets damaged and release of free radicals will be happening, and they ultimately cell damage through the formation of the reactive oxygen species. And also the one of the important aspects to the mitochondria is the inflammation, and this leads to the gene expression changes and mitochondrial proteins, several proteins associated with the mitochondria energy metabolism also gets a change in the body. And the mitochondria number, reduction in the mitochondria number causes the energy, whatever the mitochondria, less number of mitochondria is less of energy, and list of several pathways associated with this mitochondria, like electron transporter, ETC chain, and other things. So also the reduced calcium leads to the altered signaling system, and also the because of the reduced calcium, the altered membrane potential also will lead into that, and ultimately the defect in the cell survival pathways. And other way around, you can see the backs and caspases like apoptotic pathway involved in this kind of mechanisms with these toxic effects and leads to the cell death. These are all the grossly the situations which we can expect in the body, like oxidative stress, inflammation, and the calcium associated metabolism, and also the apoptosis. See, when you come back to the topic, my area of interest, there are heavy metals like arsenic, cadmium, chromium, mercury, lead, and nickel. And almost all, they all got into the body through inhalation and ingestion process. And maybe absorption through the skin and also to other systems. And this causes mostly the damage to the liver, kidney, and appetite, nausea, vomiting, and other things. But since we are focusing on lead gets into the body through inhalation and ingestion process, and it causes neurotoxicity and also lung and liver damage, and further it leads to the loss of appetite and nausea. See, the environmental lead causes continuous exposure to the leads to the growth and mental retardation, and in brain it causes neurotoxic effects and impairment of the higher functions also we can see, especially in the infants and adolescents. And continuous exposure to lead leads to the intellectual impairment also, and it leads to the hyperactivity, and there are some neurobehavioral changes also. The suppression of the cognition, learning and memory function also we can see, and the encephalopathy, coma, convulsions. These things, people normally, they won't look deeply into this. These are all the toxicity to the brain. And the elevated levels of blood in the lead can diffuse across the blood-brain barrier and leads to cellular effects and neurological effects also. The cellular effects are intracellular mechanisms leading to the nerve cell death, and the neurological effects are the brain damage and behavioral changes. And WHO says that there are 18 million people affected at presently in the throughout the world because of this lead, and there are 34 million. It may reach to 34 million by 2025. And in India, the situation is very rampant, like 4 million people will be affected by 2025. And it causes brain damage and neurobehavioral changes. And several reports are indicating that lead is a neurotoxicant. And also, lead is considered to be an important possible risk factor for the pathology of Alzheimer's disease. So Alzheimer's, one of the Alzheimer's situation where maybe lead can cross the blood-brain barrier into the brain and causes the precipitation of the amyloid peptides. And one of the reasons, possible reasons, the reports are very scanty. And in that area, really, I'm looking into that, because Alzheimer's is a, nobody can define the Alzheimer's as of now. And lead is one of the important factor to cause the Alzheimer's disease. That is what I'm hypothesizing. And if you see what is Alzheimer's, Alzheimer's is a progressive neurodegenerative disorder. The classical situation is being loss of neurons and abundance in the intraneurofibrillary tangles associated with the protein tau and extracellular deposition of the beta amyloid peptide as amyloid plaques. These amyloid plaques get into the brain and the signaling pathway will be affected. This gets precipitated. More of exposure, more of the loss of neurons leads to the tangle formation, and these amyloid peptides can form into the plaques. And these tangles are aggregates and microtubules associated with the protein tau. And this sequential proteolysis of beta secretase by the gamma secretase of this amyloid precursor protein leads to the deposition of the amyloid peptides. And the mechanism by how these plaques and tangles results into the Alzheimer's disease situation is still unknown. And the plaque formation, that is deposition of the beta amyloid peptides, causes neurotoxicity, oxidative damage, and inflammation. And the toxicity being resulted by the combination of lead and AP needs to be addressed. That is what I am doing. And also, I try to see any kind of naturally available active compound. I am working on battery compounds. Today, I am presenting only with the EGCG. And whether they have mitigative effects of these combined toxicity, let us see in future slides, coming slides. So this is the classical situation where in Alzheimer's, the formation of the neuronal plaques, and this is how it looks like, and the neurofibrillary tangles, and the plaques and combination of these two looks like this, and the normal brain looks like this, and the severe Alzheimer's disease brain looks like this. So what we can say with this slide is the formation of the neuronal plaques and neurofibrillary tangles is a classical situation. Somehow, if you can avoid the formation of these two, we can recoup the situation, get back to the normal situation. But till now, there is no drug, nothing is working. So the hypothetical situation of beta amyloid toxicity is the beta amyloid toxicity can cause the calcium signaling interruptions, and it can have effect on the mitochondria, and also it can lead to the inflammation, and there is a kind of cell signaling disruption. That means the synaptic plasticity is be affected. These are all the parameters which I'm going to touch upon today, and these all effects can lead to the neuronal cell death. And multiple pathways associated with this can lead to the dysregulation of the calcium homeostasis, apoptosis, inflammation, and alterations in the synaptic plasticity. And in this area, these are the publication, the recent publications I have, and I'm closely working with the intracellular mechanisms associated with the lead toxicity. And my goals for the today's topic is whether the synergy of the lead and amyloid peptides on human brain cells and possible protection by the EGCG in terms of viability and proliferation. I'm going to study in this and show the effects of this one. And also the intracellular effects on different biomarkers like inflammation, signal transduction, oxidative stress and apoptosis, and also DNA fragmentation, and how exposure to the EGCG can get back to the normal situation. Let us see. So these are all the methodologies which I followed. I have taken the cells, human brain cells, and cultured them in the laboratory and exposed with the different kinds of concentrations, and I found acidity values. And by considering those values, and I tried to test EGCG, and also I studied the morphology and other associated parameters with the inflammation, oxidative stress, and what you call that apoptosis. And epigallocatechin gallate is EGCG. Its half-life is 3.4 to plus or minus 3.3 hours, and the literature indicates that it can inhibit ROS reactive oxygen species levels, and it can contain the apoptosis, and also it acts against the fibrillar formation and oligomerization, and it's a very potential antioxidant. It's a potent antioxidant, and also it acts as anti-inflammatory molecule. And you see, it's a flavonoid polyphenol, and it is found highly in the white tea, green tea, and also in smaller quantities in the black tea. And the trace amounts found in the apple skin, plums, and onions. And the literature indicates that it can protect against the amyloid peptides. And it's said to be a good antioxidant and enhance neuronal proliferation and functions. This is the molecule structure. And coming to my findings. See, initially we tested with the lead we exposed to the brain, and from 1000 micromoles to the 0.001 micromoles, because it's a dose dependent study, we wanted to come to a conclusion that where narrow down to a concentration where it can show the 50% death of the cells. And further we tested with the 10^1 micromoles, and we found that 5 micromoles is a 50% IC50 values, 50% cell death we can observe there. And you can see there, as the concentration increases, the cell viability is going down. And it's a, we tested even going for, I mean, 12 hours, 24 hours, and 48 hours. That is time-dependent studies, and found that 50% decrease at 5 micromoles is very effective in all the time intervals. And we have selected 24 hours as our time period for all the studies. And we have seen for amyloid peptides, we have taken the amyloid peptide 2535 and also AP140. These two we have combined, and also with the lead, and we exposed to the brain and tried to see is there any effect in the brain. So when we tested AP2535 from the range of 2 to 20 micromoles, and we found that at 8 micromoles, 50% cell death was observed. And similarly, the amyloid peptide 140 from 20 to 120 micromoles, when you expose, we found that the around 2535 when time-dependent studies like 24 hours, 48 hours, and 72 hours, we found that 50% death was observed at 8 micromoles, and even AP140, 20 to 120 micromoles, we found that the 50% decrease of the viability observed 60 micromoles. So these two concentrations we have taken considered for further studies. So if you see the morphology of the cells, that is, these are all the cells which we have used. And control, we can see the good, the connections between the cells when go on expose this lead and also the amyloid peptides to the brain cells. and we can see that loss of connections between the cells. They become circular in shape and decrease in cell number, and also we can see the cell lysis during the process of this one, and cell texture and shape also has been changed. This is clearly we can observe here in all kinds of exposures. And even we try to have lead alone, only amyloid peptide alone, AP140, 140, and 2535 along with the lead, and lead, amyloid peptide 140 and 2535, all kinds of combinations we have studied. Before that, the loss of connections between cells that was observed, it is found to be toxic to the cells. And when EGCG was tested, whether raw EGCG is having any kind of effect on the cells, we found that there is no toxicity because it is on par with the control. And of course, 50 micromoles we started using for the further experimentation, and the viability is significantly is not affected. So it is not showing any kind of toxicity to the cells. And the cell viability when along with the lead and exposed, these are untreated cells, and these are all the cells with the EGCG, and we see the lead AP140 and all the combinations. This is all combinations like 140, 2535, and lead. You see that the viability is gone down with the all kinds of combinations of lead and amyloid peptide, and with the exposure of the EGCG, the viability has positive side. This positive means cells has gone come back and they are growing very nicely. So that means the EGCG can protect these kind of toxicities, and this is the representative slide for the cells cell viability. And we see the apoptosis. We can see the lead and all combinations showing that from 3.9% to 42.8%, the percentage of the apoptosis we can observe. And similarly, when you see the EGCG, this has gone down closely from 2.6% to 8%. See, this one is 6.2%. So it's showing that the EGCG is having a kind of a protective effect against the lead and amyloid peptide toxicity in terms of apoptosis. So here this slide showing that the apoptosis without EGCG and with EGCG, and we can see the graph changes here. These all combinations of lead and amyloid peptide showing 42.8%. Here it is showing 6.2%. That means the gross reduction of the apoptotic damage in these exposed cells, EGCG and the lead and amyloid peptide exposures. And see annexin levels also, we can see the annexin, you all know that annexin 5, the marker of early apoptosis, and peptide marker of late apoptosis. And the exposures of this, you can see the annexin levels are more here where amyloid peptide and lead. And when you expose EGCG, the levels are going down drastically and in a significant manner. It's showing that, so it is having some effect on the cell progression and mitigating the effects in terms of apoptosis. So you see the LDH is a lactate dehydrogenase, it's a stable enzyme, and it is widely used as a marker to assess the extent of peptide toxicity. It is there in the membrane. When anything happens to the cell, the outer cell membrane gets, the contents will come out indirectly. If you measure the LDH levels, it shows how much damage has been happening to the membrane in terms to the cell also. So if the levels are going up, that means LDH levels are going up, means there is a toxicity to the cell. And when the levels are going down, means it's having some high kind of protection. So when you expose EGCG in a significant fashion, the LDH levels are going down to the EGCG plus amyloid peptide lead combinations. It's showing that the cytotoxicity is being reduced with the exposure of the EGCG. And you see the ROS, you know that reactive oxygen species and oxidative stress is one of the important aspect during the toxicity. And the ROS levels are also going down with the exposures. And this has come down in a significant fashion. You can see the all exposures showing around 60%, and it is coming down to 25%. So the ROS levels one way going down, the levels, the reduced levels of ROS means it is trying to reduce the stress also, oxidative stress also. And see the lipid peroxidation, the lipid peroxidation where MDA, aldehyde levels, we measure normally. And this we did with the flow cytometry also. And we observed that the MDA levels are also going down with the EGCG exposure. That means it's having a gross effect on the oxidative stress. And other markers also we tested, like SOD, and glutathione, catalase, and for vitamin C. Vitamin C is considered to be one of the important antioxidants. Nowadays, during COVID situation, the mega doses of vitamin C is advised for the positive tested patients. That it works as a very potential antioxidant, not only in this situation, in all kinds of metabolic situations like cancer, neuro, kidney, and other diabetes. Vitamin C is a protective agent. Measuring vitamin C shows that whether oxidative stress is there in the body or easily we can say the vitamin C levels are going down, means it's having a oxidative stress, and we need to see that in one way or other the improvement of the vitamin C shows that it works as antioxidant, so oxidative stress will be going down. So these are all the slide, the values are like this here in this slide, because in all treated groups, the glutathione levels are going up and the SOD levels are going up, means it works as antioxidant. And EGCG can protect even this catalase, and vitamin C also shows that the EGCG has got an antioxidant protection mechanism in the body. And you see, this is a marker, important marker for the inflammation. If you measure the prostaglandin E2, because basically prostaglandins are fatty acid derivatives of arachidonic acid and from membrane phospholipids by the cyclooxygenase enzymes. And the elevated prostaglandin E2 levels normally reflects that body is undergoing the inflammation. So once, if you try to manage the levels, try on any mechanism which can reduce the levels of prostaglandin E2, is said to be a potential anti-inflammatory molecule. So EGCG is effectively trying to shows here it can reduce the prostaglandin E2 levels. That means it is reducing the inflammation also. You see, we have measured cell cycle with and without EGCG. Cell cycle measurement shows that arrest of S phase of cell cycle was observed in the in lead and amyloid peptide exposures, and which can normally with this here we can see the S phase is being affected with this lead and amyloid peptide combinations. But when you see the EGCG exposed to these cells, which is exposed to these kind of amyloid peptides and lead, exposures of shows that 68.9% of S phase, and where it is grossly gone down to 0.33%, means it is allowing synthetic phase, the DNA production. So this says that it is having some effect on the cell cycle also. And we have seen the thiofluorine T fluorescence, whether amyloid accumulation is there in the body, whether EGCG is having any protective mechanism to reduce the levels of the amyloid and fibril formation. The thiofluorine T is a fluorescent cell-permeable amyloid binding thiazole salt. Any kind of situation where we can decrease the fluorescence brightness says that the amyloid plaque formation is very low. So EGCG is kind of showing a mechanism here in a significant fashion. It is trying to the thiofluorine levels are, the brightness is going down, means the more less of accumulation of the amyloid plaques, amyloid peptides. So the EGCG has got the effect in reducing the amyloid plaque formation also. And another method is where a triangular formation, that fibrillar formation, also been measured by using Congo red assay. And Congo red is a benzidine based anionic diazide dye, which binds to the amyloid proteins, and the levels of congruent dose of means more of amyloid peptide protein deposition. And so in case it goes down, means there is no the reduction in the amyloid peptide aggregation, that means less of toxicity. So this epigallocatechin gallate is showing effect in reducing the toxicity amidst formation of the aggregation, beta peptide aggregation. And you see the, as I told in the beginning, amyloid precursor protein, if more this normally breaks down, amyloid precursor protein breaks down into the amyloid peptides. So once the APP broke down, means more of beta amyloid peptides. Whether here is this says that this slide says that the APP is being protected here, so that beta peptide formation is going down. And we have seen even apoptotic protein expression and the BACS and BCL2. I'm not going into the details of the BACS BCL2 and also cytochrome C, and the levels of the BACS and BCL2 were tested here. Then the possible protection of EGCG play a role, important role in the apoptotic pathway. The elevated levels of the BACS, that is pro apoptotic protein markers and BCL2, normally it gets elevated, it triggers the caspase 3. You all know that caspase 3 is a executioner caspase, where if you measure caspase 3, we can say that where apoptosis pathway is working or not. So the elevated levels of BACS an indirect marker for the apoptotic process, where it triggers the caspase 3. So the EGCG is protecting that levels of the ratio of the BACS and BCL2 is being grossly reduced here, showing that it is having an effect as an anti-apoptotic agent. And you see the calcium, more of calcium means it binds to the calmodulin, you all know that. And it is showing a kind of more of calmodulin in the body, means inhibition of the neurodegenerative pathway. So if more of calcium is there and calcium binds to the calmodulin, it will not allow the calmodulin to act. So here, the EGCG is trying to protect through the calcium signaling pathway. And you see the gap 43, one of the growth associated protein 43, and we measured the synaptophysin also, which is a synaptic, which a plasticity marker, and the neuronal development marker is gap 43. And any agent which can improve the gap 43, they can be considered as allowing the body mentally is neuronal development, and it is not affecting the neurodegeneration, it is allowing the neurogeneration. That means neuronal development is there. So the gap 43 is an indirect marker, and which we have published also on paper. And the activation of gap 43 is involved in the neuronal growth and development and neuronal regeneration at times. And any kind of mechanism associated with the inhibition of the gap 43 is considered to be toxic to the body. And where the calmodulin goes and binds to the gap 43, and it will not allow the gap 43 to function properly. Suppose in case any mechanism where calcium levels are more in the body, and it goes and binds to the calmodulin, so that it releases the gap 43, and indirectly by calcium ions only. So calcium levels raises means it binds to the calmodulin, and it growth 43, gap 43 will be allowed here, and for the development of the neuronal process. So the EGCG is helping out in improving the levels of the gap 43, and also the marker like the synaptophysin, which is more of synaptic plasticity, which is toxic to the body. So try to reduce the levels of the synaptophysin, and gap 43 levels will be improved. And see, these are all the graphs, whatever I presented here, and these affects intracellular signaling, and dysregulation of the calcium homeostasis has been observed with the toxicity of the lead and amyloid peptides, and it leads to the oxidative stress and abnormal processing of the amyloid precursor protein, and leads to the deposition of the beta amyloid peptides. And the calcium homeostasis dysregulation leads to the decreased intracellular calcium, and also the improved levels of the calmodulin, and which allows calcium binding to the calmodulin, leads to gap 43, And the decreased levels of GAF43 is associated with the toxicity of the lead and amyloid peptides. And also the oxidative stress, where you can see the increased apoptosis will be effectively been constrained by the EGCD. All these mechanisms associated with the toxicity, like abnormal ATP, the calcium homeostasis oxidative stress will be protected by the EGCG. That means EGCG acts as a protective agent in this toxicity being generated by the lead and amyloid peptides. And this is what the EGCG functions, and it try to regulate the calcium levels and try to allow the calmodulin to bind to the calcium, and also reduces the inflammation, and it tries to protect the signaling pathway and cell-to-cell connections. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Suresh, for your nice presentation and informative lecture. And
thank you.
We are delighted to hear from you regarding the lead neurotoxicity and its influences on this amyloid peptide formation in the brain cells of this patients who are having this Alzheimer's disease. Now I will request you to answer some of the questions which have come from our participants. So I will just check the questions which have been asked. One question is,
please go ahead.
How to detox lead from our system? How long does detoxification takes place? Is vitamin C effective on reducing lead poisoning?
Yeah, see, there is no detoxification mechanisms. Only thing is to avoid the lead. Nowadays, it is not possible to avoid lead because whatever we are having, the cell phone battery is having a lot of lead. And see, for our home, we put lot of, for glowing purpose, we put lot of color paints. The more brighter the colors, the more of lead. And even glass, pipes, and everywhere, lead is there. It is highly, we can't avoid that one, basically. But having a good antioxidant-rich food can try to, it can recoup the situation and it can lessen the toxicity. Mainly because I'm focused with the brain, and having good food like vitamin C can help during the toxicity situations. But once it enters the body, it will stay back there for years together in the body, because it can cross the blood-brain barrier also. It can reach brain and affects. So only way is to avoid the exposure of the lead.
The next question is, what about the role of a metal like zinc in A beta toxicity? As literature does suggest zinc to be the second most abundant element in the body after iron, and not a lot of literature is available on zinc induced neurotoxicity.
Yeah, and there are studies saying that excess zinc, if you have excess zinc also, it causes toxicity. And the iron and zinc plays an important role. If you take it, is not advisable, because iron and zinc has got effects at absorption site. They will fight each other, and each other will not allow to get absorbed into the circulation. So it is always advisable not to take iron and zinc together, it is separately. But there are reports saying that zinc is also causing neuro changes. I don't have any idea about that. Let me look into that.
Landmark study shows that brain cells revamp their DNA, perhaps sparking Alzheimer's disease. Can you elaborate this?
Yeah, the reports on Alzheimer's is day by day, different kinds of reports are coming out. And there are some reports says that the synthetic phase, where S phase has been affected, and the DNA formation will not be there. so that the damage will be there for cell cycle. But I don't think that could be the case with the Alzheimer's, because Alzheimer's is a situation where the elderly population is above 40 years. By the time everything has been done, and there are reports say that it's a genetic problem, but I don't think it's a genetic problem because reports are also inconclusive. But it is a problem with the environment. If you are having a improper environment, getting exposed to heavy metals, toxic substances, slowly it leads to the Alzheimer's situation. It is a process with there in the body for almost 10 to 15 years. Then only we can visualize that we are undergoing the process of Alzheimer's changes.
What is the mechanism by which lead may affect the fetus or embryo?
See, as I said already, lead, pregnant mother is most vulnerable, and the person carrying a mother get exposed to the lead in the environment, and knowingly or unknowingly, because it can cross the blood-brain barrier, the mother can through umbilical cord, it can enter into the fetus also and fetus brain also, because it can cross blood-brain barrier. And once the child birth is happening, you know, so the child is already been mentally retarded. We don't know even attaining the age of 1 or 2 years. Then only we realize that the child is, the cognitive functions are very low, and so that the child, we don't know the reasons why the child is less of cognitive functions. Maybe one of the reasons is the mother could have exposed in the highly polluted area. She must be working or getting exposed, and lead can go into the brain of the fetus also, to because it can cross the blood-brain barrier. So it is toxic.
Maybe this will be the last question. Can constant exposure to lead cause mental disorders like bipolar disorder or hysteria?
I can't comment on hysteria and bipolar disorders, but it can cause the toxicity to the brain. And it is, as I said, it is inevitable. We are traveling, we are living in a densely populated city where all cities are surrounded by the industries. Then industrial effluents, more of industries are releases led into the environment. We are constantly getting exposed. But only way is having a good diet and protecting yourself. And I don't have any idea about the hysteria and the bipolar disorders, but let me look into that.
So many questions are there, but as time is a constraint, so...
Ma'am, I think we can take some more questions, ma'am.
More questions? Okay. So, can we proceed for 5 minutes more?
Yes, ma'am. Sure. Please proceed. We have time.
Okay. So, the next question is, if EGCG decreases the property of apoptosis, can it cause the normal cells to lose the property of apoptosis as well?
Yeah, that's correct also. But I tested in the other way around because my study is in terms of lead and amyloid peptides. So, because lead, the combination of the lead and amyloid peptide causes the reduction in the apoptosis, means making the cell to undergo forcible death, means early apoptosis. So, normally the cells has got a process in a very specific time only it gets the undergoing death, that is a programmed cell death. But this combination of lead and amyloid peptides making the cells, forcing the cells to undergo death. So that process, whether it is can be EGCG can protect not to undergo the apoptosis, that is what we tested. And the regular apoptosis, the person is talking, I am not into that. And whether the cell is being protected to undergo the early apoptosis or not, but this EGCG is protect the cell not to undergo apoptosis.
How do we introduce EGCG to our brain?
No, EGCG is a very small molecule. We can't introduce ourselves into the brain. But if you have more of green tea, for example, guava, Goa is a fruit. The leaves are the Goa. The last, before month, there was an article in the Hindu, if you go through, I would write my name, Dr. Challa Suresh, you will get all newspaper articles about this study results, how we can have EGCG into the diet, what are the sources. So if you have EGCG, more of EGCG through green tea, only people know that only green tea is the source of EGCG because it is a catechin. But there are several foods which is having a rich of EGCG. We can have that one, and if you more of that one into the system, it can, because it can cross the blood-brain barrier, and it can help the brain function. It can rejuvenate.
Late toxication, can it affect the pancreas or not? Can this lead to diabetes?
Yeah, I am not into that area, but still there are reports saying that it can causes the damage, means toxic to the pancreas also. More of lead can cause the islets. There are reports saying that the insulin secretion is going down because of the less islets, so pancreatic islets. It means it's causing damage to the pancreas also. So that insulin production is very low. But if you can thoroughly check the literature, you'll get more of information on that. The answer is yes.
Is there any chances for the late toxicity associated with amyloid peptides causing AD lead to metastasis, further causing cancers at different sites?
Yes, but there are not many reports saying that it can cause cancer. But heavy exposures of lead, I don't know about the amyloid peptides, but exposure in a very greater concentrations, higher concentrations of the lead, can cause the kidney damage and leads to the cancer associated with the kidney and also to the pancreas. Partially, the answer is yes. And regarding to the, what you call the amyloid peptides, I don't have any information.
Yeah. This may be the last question. Already, you are getting tired of giving answers of so many questions.
My pleasure, madam. No problem.
Is there any possible correlation between plasma and brain levels of amyloid plaques in Alzheimer's disease patients?
I can't answer it right now, but definitely there will be correlation between the blood levels and also the levels of the brain, which has been accumulated in the brain. But mostly the accumulation happens in the brain only. So it's not, there is no way to test how much have been accumulated in the brain. Only the imaging facility is available, CT scan. With that, we can see the size of the brain, reduction in the size of the brain. Well, this is an indirect measure of measure saying that there are kind of damages happening to the brain, and which is along with some battery of intellectual tests and talking and other observation studies, only we can say that is associated with Alzheimer's. Otherwise, we don't have any tests saying that this is a kind of correlation with the circulation and the deposits in the brain.
Thank you very much, sir, for your wonderful presentation and along with all the data and all. Thank you once again. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, madam. Thank you.
Thank you very much, ma'am. Nilanjana ma'am also. Thank you very much, sir, for the wonderful session on lead toxicity and detoxification as well. So it was a brainstorming session, in fact, I should say. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, sir, for giving me a wonderful opportunity to be in front of VIT alumni and the students and faculty. And I should thank Dr. Karthik for allowing me to participate in this kind of conference. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am.